Good morning. And welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation at Shelter Rock. My name is Amanda Dulac, and I'm a member of Senior Seminar. Senior Seminar is our congregation's youth for 10th, 11th, and 12th graders. For the past few months, we've been working to create this worship experience and are excited to be with you this morning. I would like to extend a warm welcome to our newcomers and visitors today. We're glad that you've decided to join us and look forward to getting to know you. Immediately after the service, we will gather in the social hall for coffee, conversation, and UU Cafe, where lunch is available at a modest price. If you are a first-time visitor, please allow us to treat you to lunch. Please stop by the welcome desk in the lobby on your way into the social hall to receive a guest ticket. And now, we have a few announcements to share with you before we light our chalice. Please join me in looking over the calendar and announcements listed in your order of service. And now I invite Arden to do the center of a service.
This is the centering thought to the service. You pray for the hungry, then feed them. This is how prayer works, Pope Francis. And now, in the spirit of building the beloved community, I invite you to rise as you are comfortable to greet your neighbor and share a time in which you stood up for something you believed in.
Message wherever you stand, I'm calling every woman, calling every man. We're the generation can't afford to wait. The future started yesterday, but we're already late. We've been looking looking for the world to change. Search for a melody, search for someone to lead. We've been looking for the world to change. If you feel the same,
we have come together on this day to share our deepest concerns, speaking and singing words of inspiration and hope. We commit ourselves to what we can do to ease the suffering of others. But these are just words. The hymns we sing are only songs. Entering this place of worship, we must convert our intentions into love and action in our world. To be a Unitarian Universalist is to be passionate and unafraid to spread our beliefs to others through righteous action. May we all have the power to hope and pray for a peaceful world, but then also be strong enough to leave our homes and create one. Please rise as you are comfortable in singing hymn number 119.
Thank you. Please join us in Words and Song of Affirmation, printed in your order of service. Love is the doctrine of this congregation. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge and freedom, to serve human need. This do we affirm and covenant with each other.
This is a story about the crippled fox. A man was walking through a forest when he saw a crippled fox. The fox had only 3 legs and struggled to walk. I wonder how it manages to feed and care for itself, he thought. At that moment, a tiger approached, carrying its prey in its mouth. The tiger ate its fill and left what remained for the fox. If God helps the fox, he will help me too, the man thought. The man traveled back home and decided he would shut himself up in his house and wait for the heavens to bring him food. Just as food was provided for the fox, although he patiently waited, nothing happened. He lay there in bed, waiting for God to provide him for him as he had for the fox, but instead he just starved. Just when he was becoming almost too weak to go out and work, an angel appeared before him. Why did you decide to imitate the crippled fox? Asked the angel. The man replied, I wanted to be blessed through my prayer, but why didn't anyone respond? The angel responded, God has given you gifts and abilities to contribute to the world and make a living while looking after the crippled foxes of the world. Get out of bed, pick up your tools, and follow the way of the tiger. The man heeds the advice of the angel and begins to work for the injured foxes of the world. Now, I only have one question for you today. Which one are you, the fox or the tiger? Today's offering will be taken in support of our spring break community service trip. In April, we're participating in an immersion service learning trip with Remember, located on the Oglala Lakota Pine Ridge Reservation in the southwest corner of South Dakota. While engaged in the preservation of their culture and the environment, the Lakota are known in the modern times as the water protectors due to their protest of the Keystone Pipeline's potential environmental destruction.
Members of the Lakota Nation struggle with homelessness, poverty, joblessness, lack of post-secondary educational programs, and poor health. Remember is a nonprofit organization founded to address the ongoing challenges experienced by the Lakota Nation. The primary focus of Remember is bringing volunteers to assist in the improvement and renovation of housing. Housing is in high demand on the reservation, and often families don't have the resources to make necessary repairs. We are grateful for your generous donations. Will the ushers please come forward to receive the offering?
Thank you. on this couch, scrolling through my notes. Heart was broken, still not growing up.
Waking up to headlines filled with devastation again. My heart is broken, but I keep going. But I won't let it turn into hate. No, I won't let it change me. Never lose inside, or the one I keep inside. Now I know it, yeah, I know it. You can't take my youth away. Soul of mine will never break. As long as I wake up today, you can't take my youth away. You can't take my youth away. It's hard to sleep at night. Oh, and what's outside? Feeling hopeless. I need focus.
You hit me with words I never heard come out your mouth. To be honest, I don't want it, no.
Affirmation of Hope is a UU reading by Loretta F. Williams. We, bearers of the dream, affirm that a new vision of hope is emerging. We pledge to work for that community in which justice will be actively present. We affirm that there is struggle yet ahead, yet we know that in the struggle is the hope for the future. We affirm that we are co-creators of the future, not passive pawns. And we stand united in affirmation of our hope and vision of a just and inclusive society. We affirm the unity of all persons. We affirm brotherhood and sisterhood that allows us to touch upon each other's humanity. We affirm a unity that opens our eyes, ears, and hearts to see the different but common forms of oppression, suffering, and pain. Yet we are one, and we celebrate our hopes for human unity. Within ourselves and within the gathered community, we will discover the strength not to hide in indifference. Affirming that hope, publicly expressed, energizes and enables us to move forward. Together, we pledge action to transcend barriers, be they racial, political, economic, social, or religious. We pledge to make our tomorrows our todays.
this on?
Okay. So we have a little skit prepared for you guys today. It's called, How Many UUs Does It Take to Fix a Broken Leg? Just go to room in a day. Just go. Oh, hey, James, what's up? What? Ah! Oh, no, I think my leg is broken.
Oh, my God. Are you okay?
No.
You know, that'll really help you. I just go sign your cast. We'll help you.
But I don't even have a cast yet. Wait, call 911.
Okay, guys, do we have, like, a broken leg person here? How do you feel?
Hi, Mom.
Oh, my God, what happened to you?
I broke my leg. Please call help. What are you doing?
Okay, so Brittany, Tyler, and Ashley all say that they wish you feel better.
Thanks, Brittany, Tyler, and Ashley.
Broke your leg? No, it really can be like that sometimes.
What?
You know, practicing mindfulness and getting your chakras all I think that could really help you just have like a whole body spiritual healing, you know, from the time.
Thanks.
Your leg isn't even broken, but you just want attention.
I just want medical attention. Please help me.
Let me call 911.
Thank you.
Oh my gosh, Eli, you need some help.
Thank you.
Okay. You need to sit there, I guess. Okay. As you all just saw, this skit details how many people, when faced with a situation that may be uncomfortable, simply move on with their lives without really doing much, making the assumption that someone else will intervene. This is known as the bystander effect. People are less likely to aid someone in need when others are present because, well, they could do it instead. Responsibility nagging at these individuals diffuses across the group. Many people presume that someone else may do better at helping that person in need, which leads to nothing really happening at all. However, for change to happen, and for aid to come, there has to be just that one person to help. That person can be you. Of course, in situations like someone collapsing with a broken leg, you'd instinctively say that you would come to their rescue. But instead of just saying that, actually do it. It's vital to be that one person, because if not you, then who? There's no way to know if somebody else would ever intervene. So it's extremely important in a world where animosity can be rampant, to take action. Don't be that person who stops at just thoughts and prayers. Don't be that person who says they did all they could after simply saying sorry or feel better. Take action, however vague or scary that may seem, but if you don't, then who will? Keep in mind what went on in our skit, for it shows what happens when bystanders do nothing and move on with their days. People in need stay in need, desperate need, until somebody helps them. So, again, I encourage you not to be the one who shrugs, who walks by, who just tells Aaliyah to feel better and texts their friends after she breaks her leg, and take action, even the little things, beyond thoughts and prayers.
We each come into this sacred, oh, sorry, I'm just gonna, a little short.
We each come into this sacred space with all kinds of experience and concerns. We invite you to light candles for the worries and hopes that you have, sorry, that you have brightness within you.
Thank you.
How often are you reminded of tragedy? How often does it make its way into your daily routine? On February 14, 2018, 17 people were killed in the deadliest school shooting in America at Stoneman Douglas High School in Parkland, Florida. I'm reminded of this tragedy all the time. When I huddle behind my teacher's desk with my classmates during an active shooter drill, when I walk past the garbage bag my Spanish teacher uses to cover the window in our classroom door, or when my 8-year-old cousin asks me what a school shooter is, I have to confront my feelings about this tragedy again and again, and it hurts every time. So on March 17th, 2018, I walked out of class alongside 5,000 other students from my school. It changed my life. I struggled to keep my poster up so I could use one hand to hold my best friends. I cried on the steps of the Brooklyn Borough Hall. I'm only 17. I'm one voice in a sea of millions. This feeling of wanting to do something is what drives my Unitarian Universalist identity. The RE program and this community have given me strong ties to social activism that I will keep for the rest of my life. But with this propensity to help comes the ever-present feeling that I'm not doing enough, that what I'm doing will be forgotten about in a day or two, or that I'm not sacrificing more of myself. I feel guilt for the things I have in my life that others do not. But I don't think this feeling is a bad thing. Part of being someone who cares about the world is constantly assessing and then reassessing your contributions. I think that as UUs, we all naturally carry that nagging feeling that what we have given isn't enough. And though sometimes it keeps me awake at night, I am glad to have this feeling. I am glad that I can never do enough. I am glad that I have the social awareness not to pat myself on the back and call it a day. I am more than happy to feel shame and insecurity if it will push me to do more. I am proud that service is my prayer. Thank you.
This morning, I offer you the words of civil rights leader and organizer Fannie Lou Hamer. You can pray until you faint, but unless you get up and try to do something, God is not going to put it in your lap. I became a Unitarian Universalist at 16. However, you see, I wanted to be Catholic like my godmother. I loved the religious iconography, the reverence for the divine feminine in the form of the Virgin Mary. The idea of confession sounded wonderful to my inexperienced mind. It must be like some kind of therapy, except they tell you exactly what you need to get back into right relationship with God. But most of all, I was inspired by the Catholic worker movement and the biography of Dorothy Day. Helping those less fortunate was always a spiritual imperative that was imparted in Sunday school and in my family. Yet the Catholic worker movement embodied the integrity through their political work and internal politic of embracing poverty. I asked my godmother over and over again to take me to midnight mass, to which she agreed. However, she fell sick the day before and was unable to attend the service. The next semester in school, I began taking a comparative religion class. I was very interested in the traditions of the Roma, as well as learning more about Buddhism and Hinduism. As a high schooler, the Four Noble Truths made perfect sense, especially the first precept that all life is suffering. Our teacher suggested that a friend and I visit a local UU congregation, as my friend grew interested in the cultural expressions of Christianity, yet wasn't interested in forsaking his Jewish culture and upbringing. We started attending the UU Congregation of Silver Spring and All Souls Unitarian in Washington, D.C. The youth group we met with was an entirely separate building from the sanctuary. We met in a wooden cabin decorated exclusively by the youth group in the yard behind the church. Though I enjoyed youth group, I was curious about what happened in the worship service. Growing up Baptist, they believe the age of reason happens relatively early, therefore you go to service with your family. Upon questioning, one of my new UU friends tossed me a hymnal and told me to start there. I flipped through the pages and landed on the words of poet and author Edward Everett Hale. I am one, but still I am one. I cannot do everything, but still I can do something. And because I cannot do everything, I will not refuse to do the something I can do. These words provided a succinct introduction into the heart of what Unitarian Universalism is about. Recognizing the spiritual imperative of each of us to act while still acknowledging the very human limitations. Even with those limitations, the tenacity of spirit and the ability to persist onward. With the constant bombardment of news, radios, television, and cell phones, and the proliferation of social media, the overwhelming desire to do everything is very palpable. There are times in which we internalize we must be everywhere all the time, and maybe something bad wouldn't have happened if we were there. We accept that blame. And other times, which we receive blame from another for not being able to show up. However, it is up to us to discern, to know the difference, when we are being blamed or blaming ourselves, and when we are being called, when we are being asked to show up, when we are being asked to be accountable. In one of my favorite gospel songs, Aretha Franklin's Mary, Don't You Weep. Mary, Martha's sister, wants to hold Jesus accountable for the death of her brother Lazarus. If you had been there, Aretha sings, my brother would have not died. Jesus asked Martha and Mary to take him to Lazarus' body. As they arrived, Jesus called out to everyone gathered, for the benefit of you who do not believe, I'm going to call his name three times. Aretha Franklin transports us to that time in the way she calls out Lazarus' name. At times, accountability can be offered up in the way that Martha did, in despair and in need. At times, it will look like one of the prophets challenging you and calling out to you to wake up. In the way of Jesus, it will challenge us in more than one way. It will challenge those that may not believe that the waking up of another is possible, that they will never listen or see things from our point of view or embrace an ever-changing reality for the benefit of you who do not believe. Jesus also offered a challenge to Lazarus, calling his name three times, perhaps like a father to a sleeping school child, calling his name to wake him up. Our young prophets are calling to us today to pay attention, to pray with our feet and do what we can. What are we to do when a young one is afraid to go to school and we are having to speak honestly about active shooters before we may be ready, as Aaron did? What is our responsibility to welcome the stranger, to make space in our hearts for the acquaintance, to serve our community with humility and grace? Who or what is calling to you, and are you answering? Not answering the phone, text message, tweet notifications, or alerts. Last GA, UU Minister Robin Bartlett offered us these words: get out of the tomb, be the rising. The power of love will always overcome the love of power.
Used to keep it cool, used to be a fool, all about the best. Now please open your gray hymnal to number 188, Come, Come, Whoever You Are. And stand as you are able.
Another day, another tragedy. Men and women, children and adults, people of all races, sexualities, religions, and cultures are losing their lives. The response? Sending thoughts and prayers to those victims and their families. While thoughts and prayers are good and may help those in grief at the time, we need to do more. What if we lived in a world where thoughts and prayers were not necessary? We must unite and make a change, preventing tragedies before they happen and taking action in the event that they do. We, the people of this congregation, the people of this world, can change the world and make it a better place. It is in our hands to make a difference. We can stand together to move beyond thoughts and prayers.